Let's talk about a time you may wish you could forget. Adolescence. Saying that adolescence is complicated is an understatement. But what of the long-term consequences of our short-sighted decisions? You see, adolescent experiences such as drug use can alter and shape how the brain matures. It can shape the way connections are made, and by extension, how different areas of the brain talk to each other. And these changes can result in long-term dysfunction or impairment. Hi, my name is Christina, and I study sex differences in addiction. In other words, how specific connections in the brain, known as pathways, are differently affected by adolescent drug use in the two biological sexes. So you've likely heard of addiction, particularly in the context of the opioid epidemic. And if you've done any reading or you've talked to friends, you may have come across a molecule known as dopamine. And dopamine is often referred to as the pleasure molecule in the brain. And that's not a bad way to think about it. Dopamine is in fact released with pleasurable stimuli, like a reward or a positive experience, and it causes us to want to repeat those behaviors. It makes us feel good, and if you feel good once, you'll want to feel good again. It's responsible for that deep contentment you feel with that perfect bite of steak, or that delicious slice of cake, or whole cake. No judgment. I mean, if you never slice it, it's really just one slice, right? At least that's what I tell myself. Anyways, I started by discussing adolescence, so let me return to that for a second. Adolescence is a time of great, or maybe not so great, exploration, often including drug use. With that in mind, there's always the risk of developing addiction. And we, as a society, particularly in this current context, have to understand how males and females are differently vulnerable on the biological level. So we know that males and females are quite different. If I were to list the ways in which biologically we differ, we'd be here for hours. But in terms of how the brain responds to drugs of abuse and what that long-term effect is, that is less well studied. We don't know as much about it. For example, early adolescent drug use is a predictor of later vulnerability and propensity for addiction. But are there sex differences here? Well, there's one sex difference that we do know, which is between the first time you administer a drug and the time at which one becomes addicted. That time frame can be different between the sexes, and it can differ based on the drug in question. So what else is different? And what's going on in the brain? Well, I study amphetamine. It's a stimulant. It's very commonly used by adolescents these days. In fact, it's one of the most common drugs of abuse used by teens. And one aspect that's really fascinating is the concept of dose-dependent effects. Simply put, there can be vastly different effects depending on the dose. Dose-dependent effects. So in the case of amphetamine, low doses are used therapeutically to treat ADHD, narcolepsy, and eating disorders, and it does that really, really well. On the other hand, we have high doses, used recreationally, often abused, that lead to complex changes to neurons, to brain cells, as they're growing. It can change the way that the brain works, particularly the prefrontal cortex, this frontal part of the brain right here that's often colloquially known as the executive function area in the brain. So I want to study how amphetamine differentially impacts the development of that prefrontal cortex, of that frontal part of the brain, the decision-making part of the brain, in the two biological sexes. Now, like much of the scientific literature, most previous work was done in males, thereby essentially overlooking roughly half the population for fear of complicated hormone cycles affecting the data. Ah, the patriarchy rears its ugly head once again. Nevertheless, work done in our lab in male mice has shown that recreational-like doses of amphetamine in early adolescence, but not later, can result to complex changes to neurons as they're growing. Taking a step back, your brain, my brain, is composed of a bunch of cells, about 80 billion of them. Cells you've likely heard of, cells that are called neurons. And there are other cells as well, but for now, let's just focus on neurons. And these cells communicate with each other in highly complex ways to provide us with the everyday experience of sensation and thought. But they're also constantly changing. They're plastic. They can constantly respond to their outside environment and change the way that they function. One such system is the dopamine pathway that I mentioned earlier. In fact, this one's exceptional in that it's the only one we know of in which the cells grow across the brain during adolescence, during that early adulthood period. So they start kind of close to the center of the brain. They're growing through a part in the center, and they get to that prefrontal cortex, that decision-making part of the brain. And work from our lab has shown that these cells can be disoriented when exposed to drugs of abuse. And it can change the decisions that they make. So they reroute past their original targets into that prefrontal cortex, and once they're there, they can't make connections with their new neighbors, resulting in impaired function. And that disrupted pathway leads to a full disrupted function. And in this case, for the prefrontal cortex, that would be decision-making. So in our lab in male mice, we've noticed that as an inability to inhibit their behavior when they know they should. So when they receive a reward by not doing something and they can't abstain from it. Translated to human behavior, that would mean not being able to do something you know is wrong. And I'm sure you could see how that's dangerous in the context of drugs of abuse. Now going back to cells, imagine you're a neuron, a brain cell, trying to grow in the brain. How do you know where to go and how to get there? As humans, we use maps to navigate our complex cities. Well, now we use phones and GPSs, but still maps. But what do neurons do? Well, neurons can sense the cues around them and use those signals to guide them to their targets. Like a giant game of hot and cold, they can sense the hot, attractive cues, and cold, repulsive cues, and navigate to their targets with those cues. And there's one particular place that's very important for cells making the decision of where to go. And somewhere in the center of your brain, and that's where these dopamine cells specifically are deciding whether to stop at one target or continue growing to that prefrontal cortex, that decision-making part of the brain that we talked about earlier. Like the classic lyric, should I stay or should I go now? That is the decision each one of them. Now, as I mentioned, remarkably, these dopamine neurons are the only known case of this long-range growth during adolescence and early adulthood. So as such, they're extremely vulnerable to environmental influences like drug use. In fact, amphetamine exposure essentially reroutes and disorients these neurons, causing them to continue growing past their original targets into that prefrontal cortex and disrupting the local circuitry there. So imagine that you had to move neighborhoods, perhaps in a different country where you don't speak the language, and you didn't get to make that decision yourself. You were guided there by outside cues. But now that you're there, you're having a really hard time connecting with your new neighbors. I mean, you wouldn't be able to run your errands in the same way or connect with your community in the same way. It's the same idea with these neurons, except that their impaired function now has a great behavioral impairment as well, which is behavioral inhibition of all things, or impulsivity. And if you know anything about addiction, or if you know someone who's been suffering from addiction, or perhaps you suffer from addiction yourself, you know that impulsivity is a hallmark of addiction. So it sounds like it's all figured out, right? I've been telling you this lovely story about how amphetamine during adolescence changes the way that brain cells are growing and affecting their function. Specifically, we can have impaired behavioral inhibition in adulthood, long after those drugs have already left the system. Sounds pretty complete, doesn't it? Well, now enter female mice. My work has shown that adolescent exposure to recreational-like doses of amphetamine in early adolescence or mid-adolescence doesn't have any of the structural or functional abnormalities we've observed in males. So I spent years doing this and I wasn't able to show the exact same effects that we've seen in males. Now, exactly how this happens or why is still to be determined, but it seems that in early adolescence, females are protected to that detrimental effect of amphetamine. Meanwhile, in later adolescence, they seem to have a sort of coping mechanism that still protects them from the detrimental effects of amphetamine. So they show none of that behavioral inhibition issues that males do. So there's plenty of work to do here, and I hope that we can continue this kind of work because it's so important to understand. And one of the things that I absolutely love about the brain is that there's so much we don't know. We barely know how it functions normally, let alone when things go haywire, and even more interestingly, when we would expect to see some sort of impairment and the brain protects itself. That's really fascinating, and particularly in the context of addiction, that's very important to being able to treat addiction better in the future. Understanding these biological mechanisms allows us to better use our treatments and to create new treatments so that current individuals who are struggling from addiction can recover faster, and same with future individuals. So understanding these processes is vital to informing public health principles and developing sex-specific treatment. So in sum, my work serves as a critical step in understanding the biological basis of how drugs of abuse during adolescence affects the developing brain differently in the two biological sexes. Addiction is notoriously pervasive and difficult to treat, so it's imperative that we understand the biological basis of the disorder. And yes, it is a disorder with a biological basis that we can study more and better understand, so as to develop more effective, more targeted treatments in the future. In essence, I, like most humans, am still trying to understand women. Thank you for your time and attention.